Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Professor Sushmita Basu Majumdar from the Department of Ancient Indian History and Culture, University of Calcutta. Today you will be learning the course Indian Culture, in which the paper is Indian Epigraphy, and we will be learning the module Typological Survey of Indian Inscriptions. So the learning objectives are learning about the different types of epigraphs found in Indian subcontinent, looking mainly at the content of the inscriptions, classifying the inscriptions into different categories on the basis of their content, an overview of the subject and content of the inscriptions. This term typological survey has been used by Richard Solomon in his book Indian Epigraphy. Solomon has divided the inscriptions on the basis of their contents, and this classification is done into 10 different categories. These categories are royal, donative and panegyric, that is prashastis. So panegyrics are basically prashastis, which are eulogies of kings, but royal and donative, these are two different things added to the panegyrics. So often the eulogies also have a donative character. So in the prashastis, there is a royal donation and maybe the making of a tank or something else, and along with that the ruler is eulogized. But in this category there is another category which is purely different and royal in character. These are the Ashokan inscriptions, and we will discuss them separately. The second category are the land grants. These are donation records of lands, and these are mainly on copper plate charters, though initially they have been made on palm leaves and also on birch barks, but these specimens have not survived. And we also get certain caves where we have allusions to land donations that will be discussed in detail later. The third category here is private donations, where somebody has made a donation in his private capacity. There are several such inscriptions which are small donative records. This can be of an image, of a relic casket, of any other object. So this will not be taken up in detail, as these are multiple in number. When we look at the Indian subcontinent, we have more than 1 lakh inscriptions, and it is not viable to discuss all the inscriptions here. So we will just take up different categories altogether. The fourth category mentioned here are the memorial inscription. This forms a very major part of the inscriptions of the subcontinent, and mainly these come from the southern part of the peninsular south, that is Deccan. So the memorial inscription will also be dealt in detail later on. The fifth category are the label inscriptions. These inscriptions are very interesting because whenever a figure is donated or whenever a sculpture is made and a label is put, then it is known as a label inscription. Especially in case of the yogini temples, when we have the 64 yoginis and these yoginis are labeled, this has helped all the art historians to identify the yoginis very easily. And when we look at the Nanighat cave inscriptions, which are one of the earliest inscriptions in Deccan, and here we have a whole cave where we have the remnants of only a few feet. So we do not have the whole figure of the sculpture, only the feet has survived. But the label inscriptions help us to understand that there were figures or there were sculptures, and this was a royal portrait gallery of the Satavahanas, where the Satavahana King Simuka, his son Satakarni, his son's wife, that is Nayanika, and other princes have been depicted. Along with that, there is a depiction of Maharathi Tranakaira, who was probably the father of Nayanika. So these label inscriptions actually help us in understanding the character of the site and also help us to identify the figures that has been labeled. So whenever we get such label inscriptions, they can be categorized into this category of label inscription. The sixth one is pilgrim and traveler records. These are very important records, though very minor and often ignored, but the pilgrims and travelers, when they have traveled from one place to another, they have documented their name on monuments, on the walls and other places. And when these are mentioned as pilgrims, that is travelers to these places for some religious purpose, they can be categorized as pilgrim records. And when they are normal travelers, then they can be put as travelers record. So we will also deal this later on. Then we have cultic inscriptions, which means that these are religious inscriptions where you have reference to certain cults, like this can be stotras, the Halayudha stotra, the Shiva stotra, it can also be the Buddhist Dharanis. So all these are known as cultic inscriptions, and they are often engraved on the temple walls where these stotras were actually recited. And also the people who have come here for pilgrimage can also see them and recite them. So these are the cultic inscriptions. Now, the literary inscriptions are a very typical genre, and here we have very few dramas which have been recorded on stone. And along with the dramas, only three have survived out of the dramas, and along with these dramas, we also have certain Shataka verses which are very interesting, and these have been depicted on the walls of the temples. And like one of the examples will be the Kurma Shataka, which is not in praise of Vishnu, which is the Kurma avatar of Vishnu, rather these are in favor of Shiva, that is Shiva has been praised here. So these have been found from Dhar. So these can be put into the genre of literary inscriptions because of their literary value. Now, we will discuss them again later. There are two more categories. One is the seal and sealing inscriptions. These are very small seals and sealings. There is a difference between seal and sealing. When it is a seal, the inscription is in negative on it. Seal is something used for stamping at a certain place. So it is not a mobile object. It is kept in an office and it is actually used for stamping. So these are mainly from the adhikaranas or the secretariats. But when it is a sealing, it's a finished product and it is in positive. So the impression of the seal on a terracotta or on any clay tablet is called sealing. So it is positive. And this positive sealing is often sent with a consignment. When any consignment is being sent, and for the identification purpose, such sealings were sent. So when you get the sealings from some other place, you know that these are in displaced context. Text, and they have been sent from some other karana to another place. So we know what is the function of a seal and a sealing. Seal will be in negative, sealing will be in positive. Whenever we get a seal inscription, we should read it in mirror image. Now, the last one, that is the 10th one, is the miscellaneous category. So whatever does not fit into the above 9 categories can be designated as miscellaneous inscription. So we will take up the miscellaneous category later. Mainly the administrative records have been mentioned as miscellaneous, or whatever cannot be fit into the category of the 9 has to be put in the miscellaneous category. Now, let us begin with the royal inscriptions or the earliest inscriptions of India. But before going deep into the detail of the royal inscriptions or the Ashokan records, we have to discuss the earliest inscriptions of India. So the earliest inscriptions of India are the Harappan records, or the records of the Indus Valley civilization or Harappan civilization. And these are very small records, very small inscriptions. And only with the exception of one which has been found from Dholavira, the rest of them are only cryptic small things. But these have not been deciphered yet, and so we do not have much information. Now, after the Harappan inscriptions, we have the Ashokan inscriptions. But in between, we also have certain inscriptions which have been designated as Tamil Brahmi inscriptions. These are small graffitis, and the script employed has been mentioned as Tamil Brahmi. We will not be taking these into consideration at the moment, but we have to remember that those are mainly graffiti marks and graffiti inscriptions. And then let us discuss the Ashokan inscriptions, which are royal records. The Ashokan inscriptions are the earliest deciphered inscriptions of the Indian subcontinent. However, there is another opinion, as I've mentioned, about the Tamil Brahmi inscriptions. The Ashokan inscriptions are exortatory in character. So these are royal orders which are being given by Ashoka, and these have a typical character. These are royal proclamations, and these are of typical character. The same inscription has been found from different sites in different recensions. So the same context is repeated at different sites. The style and content is also unusual. The emperor's proclamation of moral and religious statement is found in these. The exhortatory nature is expressed in first person. Use of multiple languages and dialects and even multiple scripts is a unique feature of these records. The multilingual strategy might have been derived from the Achaemenid model. If you want to know more about the Ashokan inscription, you can move on to the course on Ashokan inscription and overview. Here is a map which shows the distribution of the Ashokan records. The Ashokan records are many in number, and they have been found all over the Indian subcontinent, right from Afghanistan to Karnataka and in Orissa, Dholi and Jaugar up to Kalsi in UP. You can divide the Ashokan inscriptions broadly into two categories, rock edicts and pillar edicts. Among the rock edicts, you have major rock edicts, separate edicts, minor rock edicts, cave inscriptions. The pillar edicts can be divided into major pillar edicts and minor pillar edicts. The earliest group among them are the minor rock edicts, followed by the major rock edicts, and then the latest group are the pillar edicts. So the pillar edicts are the last to be promulgated. Now from Ashokan inscriptions, let us move to the other inscriptions of the Mauryan period. So there are many more inscriptions which can be designated as Mauryan inscription, but they are only in the Mauryan time frame. We are not very sure whether they were promulgated by any Mauryan emperor. But when we look at the Barabar cave inscriptions of Ashok, we find at the same site, very close by in the Nagarjuni hills, Ashoka's grandson Dasharatha had also donated caves. So these are the earliest Mauryan inscription after the Ashokan inscriptions. Then there is another inscription at Mahasthan, which will be discussed in the miscellaneous category. We have the inscription at Sogoda, which is a bronze plaque, the Piprava Buddhist relic casket, the Sitabenga and the Jogimara cave inscriptions. From Kanaganahalli, a stupa has been excavated, and this is in Karnataka. And the Kanaganahalli stupa, we get an inscription which refers to Raya Ashoka. This states about how Ashoka actually stayed in the memory of the people. So here you can see the portion of the inscription which has been engraved just above the low relief panel at Kanaganahalli, reading in Brahmi characters of a 2nd century AD, reading Raya Ashoka. Among the royal donative panegyrics, that is prashastis, these are basically the eulogies of rulers, as I have already mentioned. The different types of panegyrics are, the panegyrics are eulogies where we get the eulogies of rulers. These are also of different types. It all depended on the composers of these prashastis, how they will take up each description. So it also depended on the relationship of the composer with the ruler, and it also depended on the psyche of the composer. So when you see one of the earliest prashastis, which is in Prakrit language and Brahmi script, that is Kharavela's Hathigumpha Prashasti, you find that it is a year by year account of the ruler. That is what the ruler had done in the first year, in the second year, third year, fourth year. So the actually, it's descriptive in character. So you immediately understand that the prashastikar or the composer was provided with the details or the year by year account, and he composed the prashasti out of this account. When we look at the Prashastis, we have the ancestry of the Prashastis for a long, long time. Even in the Rig Veda, when we get the Danastuti hymns, we find that these were basically the stutis which were done for the plundering chief. And when the composer does this stuti, he expects a certain kind of a return, or the redistribution will happen after the conquest has been done or the plunder has been done. So on return, the chief will provide a lump sum amount to the Prashastikar. So from there started the whole series of composing of such eulogies. But these eulogies are not on stone. So the earliest eulogy which has been engraved on stone is the Hathigumpha Prashasti from Odisha, and this is very near Bhuvaneshwar at the Hathigumpha caves in Udaygiri. The composition also depended on the composer of the record. When you look at the early medieval Prashastis, you often find a kind of a format generating. And here you get the origin of the family, the origin myth of the family. Then you also get the genealogies of the ruling family. So you find a particular kind of format evolving for the eulogies, wherein you also get the reference to the name of the composer of the Prashasti. So in the initial Prashastis, we do not get the name of the composer, but later on we start getting the name of the composers. There is another very interesting fact about the early Prashastis, that they are often engraved on the pillars, and when we get them on pillars, these pillars are often termed as Garuda Dhwaja. So Dhwaja is the term for the pillar. So you might have a Shiva Dhwaja, the Garuda Dhwaja. This also gives us the religious inclination of the ruler. So here on the slide you can see the Basnagar pillar of Heliodorus. Heliodorus was a royal ambassador who had come from Greece, from the court of Antiochidas. So here a coin of Antiochidas has been displayed. So from the court of Antiochidas, he came to the court of Bhagabhadra, and this inscription was engraved, which mentions about Heliodorus. So this pillar is known as a Garuda Dhwaja. Now you also have Vishnor Dhwaja. So the Mehrauli pillar, which does not have a figure on the top of the pillar, but definitely it would have a Garuda or a figure of Vishnu on top, since it's a Vishnor Dhwaja. Then Skandagupta's Bhitari inscription can be considered as a Shiva Dhwaja. So here on top we might get a bull or the figure of a Shivalinga or Shiva. Among the other inscriptions, we have the Junagarh rock inscription, which is one of the earliest Prashastis in chaste Sanskrit. And here you get the reference to many things which are very, very important, particularly how documentation was done and how records were kept is reflected by the reference to the Sudarshan Rath, that is the Sudarshan Lake. And this lake was actually damaged, and there was an attempt on part of Rudradaman to beautify the whole city and repair the lake. So this records that the lake was built during the time of Chandragupta Maurya. It's almost 400 years of history which has been recorded in this Junagarh Prashasti of Rudradaman. And it also mentions that during the time of Ashoka, a Yavana governor called Tushashpa had added conduits to this Sudarshan Lake. All these things actually indicate how the tradition and history was recorded either in memory or orally or any other form, maybe in palm leaves or any other perishable item. And that is the only reason why we get this recorded in the Prashastis. So it is very interesting to note that the Junagarh Prashasti is engraved on the same rock where two more very significant inscriptions are found. One is the Ashokan inscription, which does not refer to the Lake Sudarshan, but the Ashokan inscription rock was reused by Rudradaman to engrave his Prashasti. And the same rock was again used by Skandagupta, who engraved his Junagarh Prashasti on this rock. So it was a very significant kind of a rock. Then here on the screen, you can also see the Hathigumpha site where the inscription was engraved on the top of the cave, and people could read it out, and the people might have gathered at Hathi Gumpha to read this inscription. Now, the inscription, as I have mentioned, also are dedicatory or also donative in character, and also mention dedication of waterworks. The Talagunda inscription of Shanti Varman is one such where a waterwork has been mentioned as a dedication, and there is a pillar here at Talagunda Praneshwar temple. As I have already mentioned, that there was a tradition of recording the name of the composer. So we get the name of the composer from the Allahabad Prashasti, wherein Harishena records his name, and he also mentions how close he was to Samudragupta. The closeness of Harishena to Samudragupta, and he also worked as a minister of Samudragupta and as a hereditary minister almost, because his father was also a Mahadandanayaka, and he was also a Mahadandanayaka and also worked as a Sandhi Vigrahika, which mentions that he knew about the administration very well, and that is the only reason why he has divided the conquests of Samudragupta into different categories, and he has mentioned every detail. And towards the end of the Prashasti, he also gives detail about his family and his closeness with the king. Similarly, we also have the names of Ravi Kirti in the Aihole Prashasti, Uma Pratidhar in the Deopara Prashasti. So gradually the composers were giving their names on the Prashastis. Here you have the Aihole Prashasti of Pulkeshin II, and the poet was Ravi Kirti. You have the Deopara Prashasti of Vijay Sen, and the poet is Umapatidhar, and the characters are beautifully engraved on the Prashasti. Now let us move to the land grants. As I have mentioned, that the land grants were initially given and the records were kept much later. So the earliest of the land grants are those of the Satavahanas to be recorded on their caves, and we get several land donations to the Buddhist Sangha, and these have been recorded on the stones. So the Satavahana records are not on copper plates, but usually, as I have mentioned, that the land grants are on copper plates. But there is a very interesting inscription from Kurud, which is of Narendra. Narendra was a Sharabhapuriya king and from central India, that is present day Chhattisgarh. And from the site of Kurud, we have an inscription which mentions that this record was earlier given on a talapatra, that is a palm leaf. And due to a conflagration at the Doni's place, the inscription was actually burnt. And this loss was reported to the king, that is Narendra. And Narendra ordered an official probe into the whole matter, whether the Dhoni actually holds the land or not. And when it was confirmed, it was redonated on a copper plate. So this gives us the information that land grants were also given on talapatras, on birch barks, and such perishable items which have not come to light. But most of the land grants have been found on copper plate charters. These copper plates are longish, so they are almost modeled like the talapatras, and at the end of these talapatra type of copper plates, you get a small hole, and this hole was used to string the copper plates together with the help of a ring. So a ring was used and all the copper plates were strung together, so that somebody does not replace one of the copper plates from this and forge it, or just mention a larger land or something else. So there was an official seal by which the string was actually locked. But later on, we also get certain land grants on copper plates which are large and on which the official seal comes on the top. Here on the screen, you can see the Barakpur copper plate of Vijaya Sena, or even the Jagjivanpur copper plate of Mahendrapala, which are large inscriptions on single copper plates, and the seal is attached on the top of these. So the early inscriptions, as I have already mentioned, are the Satavahana cave inscriptions recording land donations, and later a format evolved which can be divided into three parts. So whenever you get the land grant, you can see that there are three stages in which the land grant is actually written. The first stage is the stage of preamble, which is actually invocation and introduction to the land grant. The second is a notification, and third can be called a conclusion. So in the preamble, you get invocation, then the place of issue, then the grantor's name and genealogy, and address to the officers and authorities who are to be officially informed of the transaction, that is the land transaction. In the notification portion, you get the specification of the gift, the name of the location of the granted land, occasion on which the land has been granted, that is, it may be a Sankranti, it may be the ruler's coronation or something, the occasion on which this particular land has been granted, the intention and or the function, or for example, mentioning the merit from the grant. So usually a grant was given, a dana was given to attain punya, that is merit. So this is also mentioned in this portion. The conclusion portion is very interesting, as it has the exhortation. The grant is given for perpetuity till the sun and the moon, so Achandra Taraka. So this term Achandra Taraka, or till the sun and the moon exist, till the sun and the stars exist, till the moon and the stars exist, such kind of the term has also been used very, very early, even in the inscriptions of Dasharatha. The term comes as Achandra Shulyam, till Chandra and Surya are there, till the sun and the moon are there. So it continues even in the land grants. And then it mentions the evils of violating this grant, and even the ruler actually mentions what are the evils and how you will be punished if you do this. So then comes the date portion. So for mentioning that these the violations are mentioned by giving curses, which are very interesting. So in your next life, how you will be born and how you can become an animal, or your family can turn into a curse, that has been mentioned in this imprecatory benedictory portions. Then comes the date and the name of the officers and functionaries, like the dutaka, the composer, the scribe, etc. And finally, in some of the inscriptions, you also get the official authentication by the ruler himself, and at times the ruler himself signs it. Like Harsha's signature is one of the most beautiful signatures which you get on the copper plates. It mentions Swahasta Mama. So it has been done by my own hands. So the ruler was also a very good calligrapher, and he mentioned it. So the Baskera copper plate of Harsha has the signature of the ruler himself. Now let us move to the memorial inscriptions. From land grants, now we move into the fourth category, and I'm skipping the private donations because I've already mentioned that the private donations are small records wherein it records small gifts. Though these are minor, but very significant one. The memorial inscriptions are also very interesting, and as the term memorial mentions, like as the term memorial means in memory of. So it's in memory of a deceased person. And when you look at the category of different memorial inscriptions, you find that these are very regional in character. And in each region, a different kind of a word is found. So when you look at the inscriptions from Maharashtra, you often find the word Chaya or Chaya Stambha. That is the reflection of the deceased person. Chaya means reflection. And when you look at the other inscriptions from Western India or Northwest and North India, you get the terms Paliya, Yashti, Chhatris, Govardhans. And there is another category which is again very interesting. When the husband dies, the wife performs the ritual of self-immolation, and this is designated as Sati. So these are called Sati memorials, and often we find on the Sati memorials that these are uninscribed, and there is a depiction of one hand which is raised like this, and on one side of the hand you get the sun and on the other side you get the moon. That is, if you die like this or if you perform Sati, you will go directly to the heaven. So we also find multiple hands which also indicate that the ruler had actually taken up polygamy and he had several wives. So you can count the number of hands and immediately understand how many wives that particular ruler had or that the particular person had. So this category is the Sati memorial inscriptions, and these have been mainly found from central India. Then we have Buddhist memorials, which record the dedication of stupas containing relics of the monks, and the Jaina memorials form another category. And there is a term which is found on the Jaina memorials, it's called Nishidhi. And Nishidhi means that the stone on which the Jain monk had performed Sallekhana is later on engraved and it is erected. So we will come to this a little later, but let us see some of these memorial inscriptions. These are the Paliyas. So Paliyas are mainly those which are the memorials of chiefs, and when it is Govardhan, it actually means that it's a cattle raider who had gone for Govardhana, Govritti. So for enriching himself in the number of cattle which he has, and in this process of plunder he has lost his life. This is a Sati memorial where you can see the upraised hand of the lady and also another person who might be her husband, and often these do not even have sculptures and only a pillar has the hand upraised and the sun and the moon is depicted. There is another category which is known as Chhatri. The word Chhatri actually comes from Yashti to Lathi to Chhatri, and these are very late Chhatris which I am showing here, and this is the Chhatri of Udaiban Singh from Dholpur, and even much later Chhatris have been built. So Chhatri inscriptions are a different category altogether. As I had already discussed about the Jaina memorials, here is one of the earliest Jaina memorials from Chhatagarh, which is very near Durg district in Chhattisgarh. And on a very large stone, we have an inscription which reads, Nisa Chhaya Sidha Nega Masaraha. So here the term Chhaya has been mentioned, but what is interesting is the addition of the term Nisa to Chhaya. So Nisa Chhaya actually means that it's a Nishidhi. So the term Dhi of Nishidhi has been termed as Chhaya or has been replaced by Chhaya. So Nisa is actually a technical term which has been appended to this. And Sidhanega Masaraha means Ratha is being termed in Prakrit or has been mentioned in Prakrit as a Raha, because Tha becomes Ha as per the rules of Prakrit, and Ratha means a member. So this is a member who is mentioned as Sidha. So the person is actually a member of the Siddhas. Who is a Siddha? A person who has attained heaven, like who has performed Sallekhana or who has performed the ritualistic death and has become a Siddha has been mentioned here. So his Nishidhi has been erected here. Now, among the memorial stone inscriptions, the Eran inscription of the time of Bhanugupta records the death of Goparaja in a battle and his wife's performing Sati. So it is very interesting that at the same time it's a Sati memorial and it is also the memorial of Goparaja. There is another inscription from Shravan Belgola which mentions that Acharya Prabhachandra had performed Sallekhana and he had survived for long time fasting. So the days mentioned here are 33 days. So a monk had fasted for 33 days and performed Sallekhana, and after his death, after his performing of this process of Sallekhana, the ritual of Sallekhana, his memorial was raised, and this is known as the Nishidhi memorial. Chandravati inscription which is dated to 12th century, mentions the daughter's death, which is again very unique. So the daughter's death has been commemorated in one of the inscriptions, whereas we also get wife's memorial. So a male person has actually commemorated the death of his wife, because often in sati memorial inscriptions we find that it is the death of the husband which is actually commemorated. But here in Sangsi memorial stone inscription, we get just the opposite, that the husband is actually commemorating the wife's death. Basi inscription of Chahamana king Ajay Paladeva commemorates the performance of sati by his three wives. So it is his commemorative inscription, that is the death of the Chahamana king Ajay Pal. So it's a royal memorial inscription as well as it is a sati memorial inscription. So there are several memorial inscriptions which have been found in India, and the predecessors of such inscriptions are actually the memorials which have been found all over Deccan and also in far south, which can be called as Virakkals or Viragals, that is the hero stones, and also the megalithic burials, which were actually uninscribed. But later on we find that there is a long continuity, and several memorials were actually inscribed. There is a very interesting inscription from Chhatagarh which mentions a Gharaniya Samanika Chaya, that is, it mentions that a Gharani, a housewife or a lay householder female, was a Shramani, that is a monk. So it's a combination of a Gharani and Shramani who is actually performed the Sallekhana on a stone, and on the stone her memorial was made. But the term Nishiti has not been used for her. So it's only mentions it as Chaya. So there are many more inscriptions which can be discussed, but we will restrict ourselves to this. Let us move to the cultic inscriptions. The cultic inscriptions have the purpose which are purely religious or devotional. In Brahmanical context, the devotional texts, mantras, stotras, etc. on the temple's walls and pillars are engraved, and these can be called the cultic inscriptions, like the Halayudha Stotra, which has been found from Mandhata. But when we move to the Jain context, we can mention a very significant inscription which records a Purana, that is the Uttam Shikhara Purana, which is not found in any other source, like in any other material. So the only reference to this Purana comes from an inscription, that is the Bijolia rock inscription, which records this otherwise hitherto unknown Purana. Among the Buddhist inscriptions, we can find sutras like Nidana Sutra, Pratitya Somutpada Sutra, etc., which are engraved on bricks and have been found in large numbers from Nalanda. Prayers on stones with Om Mani Padme Hum can also be considered as cultic inscription or cultic in character. We also get several inscriptions with the Ye Dhamma words, and this can also be regarded as the cultic inscriptions because the purpose is basically cultic. Now from this, let us move to the category of literary inscriptions. As I had mentioned in the beginning, that we have got till now three dramas on stone, and all these three dramas are almost incomplete. It is very surprising that why on stone such large dramas were actually composed and engraved, because it's a very tedious job. And one of them is the Parijat Manjari Natika. It is being mentioned as a Natika because it's small. A Nataka has 10 episodes, whereas a Natika will have only 4 episodes. And along with this, we have the Harakeli Nataka, we have the Lalita Vigraharaj Nataka, and both of these have been found from the mosque, that is the Arhai Din Ka Jhopra Mosque. And the Parijat Manjari Natika has been found from Madhya Pradesh, Thar, in the Kamal Maula Mosque. So all these dramas have been recovered from mosques, which is again very interesting. These mosques were basically temples and later on turned into mosques and often had large spaces where dramas could be performed. In these dramas, there is a typical feature that is the male characters speak in Sanskrit and the female and the menial characters, they speak in Prakrit. So it's in conformation with the tradition of composing of the Sanskrit dramas that such dramas were composed. There are Mahakavyas as well, which are engraved on stone. Among these may be mentioned the Raja Prashasti Mahakavya of Ranchod at Udaipur. Though in form, this is a Mahakavya, but in content, it is primarily eulogistic and dedicatory. We also have Mahakavyas on stones, and one of the examples is the Raja Prashasti Mahakavya of Ranchod at Udaipur. Though in this form, it's a Mahakavya, but in content, it is primarily eulogistic and dedicatory. So we cannot just put this into the category of pure literary inscription. From here, now let us move to the category of travelers and pilgrim records, which are very interesting, as I have mentioned. And here you can see on the screen the record from the Nagarjuni cave number 2. Which has originally the inscription of Dasharatha, which is a donation to the Ajivika monks. But the traveler record which I am mentioning mentions a yogi whose name is actually not mentioned properly. But besides having the inscription of Dasharatha, this has the record of a pilgrim or a traveler who was a sage, and it is mentioned as yogi. So his name has been mentioned as Karma Martand Yogi, which is again very interesting, though this person would have been a semi-literate person because he makes many mistakes in the in writing his name. While writing Karma Martanda, he makes a spelling mistake. But he visited here with his three sons or three followers, is mentioned here as in numerals he mentions three, and Suttu, which is actually means his three sons. So Karma Martanda Yogi visited this particular cave, that is the Nagarjuni cave in the Jehanabad district of Bihar, and had engraved his name here. So such records actually help us to understand who visited this particular place at what time, because when we look at the Barabar caves and also the Nagarjuni caves, we get a reference to another person who is mentioned as Acharya Yogananda. So he actually is worshipping another deity who is Shiva, and that particular Shiva is mentioned as Siddheshwara. So the inscription mentions him as Acharya Yogananda the Pranavati Siddheshwara. So we also come to know when the temple of Siddheshwara actually came to be being, actually when it was actually built or constructed. So from this inscription we come to know about this Acharya Yogananda and also the time frame of the Siddheshwara temple. There is another very interesting inscription which is found on several things, you know, like you get that inscription on temple walls, on panels, you get them on sculptures, and it starts from Maharashtra, Bihar, Chhattisgarh, moves on to Bengal and Bangladesh, and it mentions a single yogi whose name is Makaradhwaja Yogi or Magaradhwaja Yogi. And after the name of Magaradhwaja Yogi is a numeral, that is 700. So it was speculated that what is the number actually, is it an era, is it a date or what? But later on we come to know that it is the number of followers of Magaradhwaja Yogi which has been mentioned here. And on several sculptures you get them. From Bangladesh, on three sculptures you get the name of Magaradhwaja Yogi, who actually did not get the sculptures erected or constructed, but wrote his name on whatever material was available. He also mentions his name on one of the Shivalingas. So on this particular Shivalinga from Shergarh, you get the name of Magaradhwaja Yogi and 700 as well. On a sculptural panel from Pachrahi again, you get this Magaradhwaja Yogi. This is from Kumarpara in Bangladesh, where you get, instead of 700, shisha, that means shishya. So he had 700 shishyas, is clear from this particular inscriptions. Again, on an inscription from Mahasthan, the same yogi mentions his name. So we now can record the journey of this pilgrim or this yogi from Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh to Bihar to particularly to Bengal and Bangladesh. Now we have moved on to the last category, which is the miscellaneous category. As I had already mentioned, in the miscellaneous category, we can include everything which cannot be included in the previous 9 categories. So among these, the major ones are the administrative records, that is the Mahasthan and the Sogoda inscriptions. And we also can include other inscriptions like the Sitabenga and the Jokimara inscription, the secular foundations recording excavations of tanks, wells, etc., which do not have any other kind of a character, donative or royal, or any panegyrics added to them. These can be mentioned. And then there is a very interesting kind of an inscription which is found from Malwa region in Madhya Pradesh, from Dhar, from Un, and from several other places, and it's called a Sarpabandha, that is a Varnanaga Kripanika, which is used to learn grammar. So it's in the form of a snake, and the cryptic codes are being written, or the sutras are being written of grammar. And this is how the students were actually taught grammar. So once it is engraved on the temple wall, the Sarpabandha, and then it will be used as a demonstrative lecture, delineated Sarpabandha, to teach the grammar sutras. And this has been found mainly from Madhya Pradesh. So this was a tradition of the Malwa region. Then we can also have several footprint inscriptions, mainly the Buddha Padas. As I mentioned about the Sitabenga and the Jogimara inscription basically mentions a Devadasi, that is Sutanuka. And the Sitabenga inscription is actually mentioned as an inscription which was previously thought to be a love poetry, but now it is taken as the finishing of the cave and handing over of the cave, which has been documented. So these two are the Sitabenga and the Jokimara inscriptions, are Mauryan records. And finally, before ending, I should also mention about the Mahasthan record is in Prakrit and Brahmi characters, and it mentions about a loan being given to the people of this region, and it also helps us to identify Mahasthan with the region of Pundranagara. So the name of this place was Pudanagala or Pundranagara, and the people of the Pundranagara have faced an emergency situation, and this emergency situation is known as Atiyayika. So in this kind of an emergency situation, they are being given a loan from the government, obviously, though it's not mentioned here, but on behalf of the local administration or on behalf of the administration, they are being given a loan, and when the good days come back, they have to refund it in the form of cash or in kind. So it's mentioned that when the good days are back, please return this. So this is a very unique kind of a loan document which is contemporary to the Mauryans. And thus we come to the end of the different types of inscriptions which have been found from the Indian subcontinent. This is a broad overview which I have given you about the contents of the inscription. It is very important to look at the content and how things develop in the Indian subcontinent. So typological survey is an attempt to understand the nature or the character of the inscription and how actually the particular inscription is important or significant and how it is conforming to the tradition and how it is different from the tradition can be understood by taking these into consideration. And as I have mentioned in the beginning, that we have more than 1 lakh inscription from the whole Indian subcontinent. So while taking up a particular category, one has to understand the content, the style, the script employed, the language employed, and also understand the historical importance of the epigraph, and then use it as a tool for understanding or for reconstruction of history. Thank you for attending this lecture on typological survey of inscription with me, Professor Sushmita Basu Majumdar. Thank you for learning more. Come to the EPG Pathshala. Thank you.